So this is love. So this is love. So this is what makes life divine.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Jackie Suarez, and welcome to Living Arts. Today is our premiere show. I'm thrilled that you're tuning in. I developed this program because I live in the surrounding area and the artists here are absolutely fabulous. Outside of New York City, I think you'd be hard pressed to find such an eclectic group of artists. So that's the premise of this show. What you just heard is a cut from Someday My Prince Will Come, and that is by Alexis Cole. She's our guest this evening, and I'd like to welcome her to the show. Alexis, welcome.
Thank you so much for having me, Jackie.
How are you?
Great, thanks.
I've had the pleasure of seeing you perform in downtown Peekskill at the Division Street Grill. Mm-hmm. And why don't you give our audience a little background on how you got started in the music business?
Sure. I was 4, and my mom dropped me off at preschool. And when she picked me up, I was tap dancing and singing on a tree stump. And pretty much I think it's been is that up or downhill from there?
It's been uphill.
Yeah, my grandmother was a singer and pianist, and that's my mother's mother, so on that side of the family. And then my father is also a singer and pianist, so pretty much I just do what everybody before me has done.
Oh, terrific. Do you play any other instruments besides the keyboards?
I play a little bit of didgeridoo. And
what is that exactly?
That's that Australian instrument that makes like the drone. Didgeridoo impression. And I play some cowbell. I like to do like drum circles usually
awesome.
During the summer. And of course I'm the singer, so I like to be the cowbell player because I like to be the lead.
Okay.
And I also play some folk guitar. I really love folk music. I grew up listening to Judy Collins. She's like one of my favorite. I always say she's my first singing teacher.
Okay.
And I've actually gotten to meet her recently. Somebody who works on my albums is her producer, and so I got to go to her Christmas party and
and
hear some of her shows recently. So that's been really neat. But I play some folk guitar, and I also play the tambora, which is an Indian drone instrument that goes like.
So you're kind of into. Percussion or something along those lines.
Yeah, well, that's percussion. I studied singing in India, actually, for a while. And
oh, really?
So that's where I learned to play. It's not a very hard instrument to play, but the fact that I have one is kind of cool because they're not so easy to come by. I brought it back with me from India.
Okay, so that's you started taking lessons when you were 4.
Piano lessons.
Would you say that you're basically classically trained, or did you always kind of go into
modern? I did what the same piano books that other kids do, so... I studied piano. I took piano lessons weekly, like all the way through, through most of elementary and middle school. And then in high school, I kind of started doing my own thing. I started taking singing lessons in high school. I went to like a School of Music and Art up here. I grew up in Miami. So it's called the New World School of the Arts. It's a college and a high school together, and we had 3 hours of arts training a day. It was really an amazing program.
That's awesome. I was actually going to ask you where you went to school.
Yeah.
So are you from the Miami area?
I was born in Queens, and then I grew up in Fort Lauderdale because my grandmother moved down, and so my family followed her.
Oh, terrific.
Like all good Jewish grandmothers, she moved to Florida. So
that's awesome. So tell me a little bit about what happened when you left school and how your career took off from there, or how you started performing.
Yeah, well, I was I feel so blessed that I've always known what I wanted to do. I always knew I wanted to be a singer somehow. And when I was in high school, actually, I was studying musical theater, and I thought that would be the direction that I would go in.
Mm-hmm.
And in my senior year, I got a gig on South Beach at a hotel, and it was I really needed the money, and I was like, oh, a gig, that's so great. And then so he said I had to learn all these songs, so I started listening. Like, he gave me a cassette tape with all the songs, and it was all like Billie Holiday and Elle Fitzgerald and Sarah Vaughan. I was like, oh, duh. That is what I'm supposed to do. So it was then that I decided to become, just a jazz singer. And it was right before college, so I changed trajectories and decided to go to school for jazz vocals. And I studied for 2 years in Miami, at the University of Miami.
Okay.
And then I transferred up to New Jersey to William Patterson and finished my undergraduate there. And then I started working right away. I was just doing a lot of gigs. And I moved down right after that to North Carolina, where I was really working a lot. That's like it's great to be a big fish in a small pond.
Oh, yeah.
And I was living like in the Chapel Hill area, and okay. working in Raleigh and Durham, and teaching a lot. I had a lot of, there's a lot of adult learners there. It's a really bright group of people there with the research and like all the universities and everything. So,
have you always been lucky enough to be able to just do your music and not have what people call a straight job?
Well, when I first moved back to New York, so after being in the Triangle area in North Carolina, I did a cruise ship gig for like a year, mm-hmm. and I saved up about $6,000.
Wow.
And I was like, when I get done here, I'm going to move to New York. And so when I moved to New York, I worked on a commune for a little while in Staten Island.
Really?
Which was really cool. I was like the pantry
clerk. I didn't think there were that many around.
There's not that many, but there's one in Staten Island. What's really great.
What's it called?
It's called Ganes. They're still there. They have a lot of international students that stay with them. You pay like a small fee and you get your own room, and then there's like 10 communal houses. And
Very
we like
nice.
Eat together. It was a great, you know, springboard, and I made a lot of friends when I was new in town, so it was really great.
Isn't that kind of on the level of like a kibbutz?
Yeah, kibbutz is a type of commune.
Yeah.
But it's like, usually I think it's more rural, whereas, you know, this was like an urban, we weren't doing too much farming.
Right, exactly. It wasn't agriculturally based.
Right. But anyway, when I first got to New York with my big $6,000, that ran out pretty quickly. So I had to, at that time, I was modeling for art classes. That was like a really fun thing. My mother had done it when she lived in New York, along with being a cabbie. My mother's awesome. And
they make a lot of money, cab drivers, so.
Oh, that's, I don't know. That, I so.
In another life,
my friend
maybe I'll be driving a cab.
That. He's a drummer. Mm-hmm. And he said he didn't know how much, whatever, he didn't know how much they made, and he was like, I don't know what I'm doing wrong. And other cabbies were like, no, that's about how much I make. But it
really?
Wasn't really that much. We make, honestly, like musicians, I mean, it's not, obviously nobody does it for the money, but mm-hmm. sometimes, you know, if you book some parties or you get some steady work or you're teaching, you can make a good, a really decent living, and it's really pleasant. So, but anyway, since 2005, I haven't done anything except music, because the modeling, actually, I started modeling, I was at the 92nd Street Y, mm-hmm. and I met the person who was the assistant director of the music program there, mm-hmm. and then he suddenly became the director, and he loved me, and he gave me a job teaching singing there, so that was a much better paying job, and obviously in my field, and then at the same time, I got my master's degree from Queens College. I was working on that, so after that, I was teaching at a university, and then since then, I've done some long-term gigs in like lounges, you know, abroad and stuff, so I've really been making, and now I'm in the band with the U.S. Army, so
That's
I've been making
right.
a decent living playing music, which is really, people ask me sometimes, like, what do you want to do with your life, you know, and I'm like, I'm doing it, you know, I'm a successful, self-supporting musician, and, like, just to accomplish that and be making albums and playing gigs, like, you know, I mean, there's a long way up from where I'm at now. I won't say there isn't, but,
right,
like,
but
I feel
not
successful.
A, yeah, there's, you know, not a whole lot more you can ask for with something
really
like that.
Isn't.
I mean,
it's a
you're
beautiful
doing
thing.
What you love, and
yeah.
you can still make a living from it. And you touched on the fact that you are in the Army. So
yeah.
why don't you tell us how that all started and what it takes to be in the Army. Did you have
sure.
to go through basic training?
I did, yeah. Well, it's kind of a cool story. So I was, you know, I was traveling a lot before then. I was doing these gigs in Tokyo, and I was staying with my boyfriend in Toronto, and then coming down to New York like every month. And the gigs were long-term gigs, like 3 months, and I was just getting, I didn't have an apartment of my own at the time, and I was finally getting like really weary of traveling.
Mm-hmm.
And I was, you know, I blog a lot, and I was writing in my blogs. People who followed me started to see a trend towards like, gosh, Alexis is really ready to settle down somehow. And, you know, I was getting into my 30s, and I was just really ready for a change. And yet I was still making all my money from traveling, so I couldn't see how I could do that. And right before I left for what became my last Tokyo, 3-month-long Tokyo engagement mm-hmm. in a lounge, I got an email from my voice teacher from college, and she said, you know, about this audition for the spot with the West Point Band's big band called the Jazz Knights. And I thought, that is so weird. I could, you know, I don't even know if I could be in the Army. It'd be so weird. But I thought, let me withhold judgment until I get the gig, and if I get the gig, then I'll worry about it. But I was really worried because I was going to Tokyo, and how am I going to audition? But it turned out that I sent my package in, you know, with a note saying that I wasn't getting back for, you know, until May or whatever,
and, mm-hmm.
and they wrote back that the audition was actually scheduled for the week that I returned. So
okay.
I figured this is fate. So I went and auditioned, and you know, I loved, the place is so gorgeous, and the band sounded amazing, and when they offered me the gig, I just said, oh my God, hooray, this is an amazing opportunity. So yeah, and so then they said, great, we want you. All you have to do is go to basic training.
I know, that must have been a little daunting for you to have to do that.
You know, before it happened, I had this like weird curiosity. I'm like, wow, I'm gonna do basic training. That is so cool. And it's so, like, it's this is like joining the Army is like the weirdest thing I could imagine, and I'm doing it. And I really liked that I was gonna freak out all my friends and my, you know, people who've been following my blogs by doing something that was so like, you know,
out of left field.
Totally out of left field for me.
It's great that you even got through basic training. If I had to do anything like that, to be quite honest with you, I don't know if I would make it.
Dude, if I could do it, you could do it. If I could do it, anybody could do it. I mean, you just have to, like, really, it's a game of patience. Like, I just felt like I was waiting, like, all the time. It was like I became like a guru, you know, or something. Like, I mean, I was just like meditating all the time because you're standing at attention, you know, and waiting before every meal. And there's really like, you know, it's interesting. It relates to your topic of your show. But the one thing that I was just dying for when I was at basic training was art. I mean, I have such a rich, full, like, mental life here. You know, I'm surrounded by beauty, not just natural beauty, but, you know, I go to museums and I listen to music and I see movies and I read. And in basic training, you can't have books.
And oh my goodness.
You can't.
That explains a lot.
I mean, you have to like be studying. You know, it's not brainwashing, but it's
indoctrination.
You know, indoctrination, right?
I mean, not in a bad way. Not in a bad way.
Believe me, a lot of these kids who are 18 and they don't know their left foot from the right foot. You know, it's good for them to be in this concentrated environment mm-hmm. where they can really focus on growing up, and that's really what they're trying to teach you is how to like become responsible, and they really drill in like the Army values, which are really a great set of values to have in your life, especially if you're young and you don't have a lot of world experience. It can be a great thing. But I was so starved for art and for mm-hmm. beauty and for poetry, and I kept writing letters to my I was actually writing a blog at the time, which I'm looking to publish at the time now, after the fact. And I was writing to people like, please send me poems, send me postcards with beautiful works of art on them, because I was just like, I felt like I was starving for art and for culture. And I mean, it's where I went to basic training was in Missouri, and the landscape there is really beautiful. It's just very like, it's very flat, but it was very wooded on this base, and I feel like I appreciated the beauty of nature like in that time more than I ever have in my life.
Yeah, because it was almost like going away. Like I went to school in a very rural place, and I grew up in the city. And when I went there, I was like taken aback by how beautiful everything was, and just being around more trees than I was used to.
Yeah.
My friends actually used to tease me about it. But you've traveled quite a bit. Why don't you give us a little idea about where you've been going recently, or some of the places you visited?
Sure. Yeah. Well, I just came back from the Chicago Jazz Festival, and that was a really neat trip.
Oh yeah? Who else was performing there?
Well, actually, I was performing with this group with Pat LaBarbera, the great saxophonist from Canada.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, and we performed this music, which we recorded recently, which is going to be coming out next year. It's the music of Pepper Adams, the great baritone saxophone player. I diverge a little bit from your question, but Pepper Adams' dying wish was for lyrics to be written to his ballads, and this man who's a super fan of his has put together 4 discs of all his compositions, like a compendium of all his compositions. And then he also commissioned lyrics from this wonderful poet, Barry Wallenstein, who used to teach at City College, who's very distinguished. And I worked on the poems with Barry, so we've just recorded these 7 songs. It's really an amazing artistic collaboration. Mm-hmm. So,
where is the studio where you're putting all this together? Is it in Westchester?
No, it's already been done.
Okay.
Yeah. And we actually recorded it in Chicago.
Oh.
Yeah, so I flew out there, and this other great tenor player, Eric Alexander, who lives, I think he lives in the Bronx, which is close to Westchester. So we flew out there, and the rest of the band was from Chicago. But we're going to be releasing it on Motema next year, which is a Harlem-based label, which my Christmas CD is on.
Oh, terrific.
Yeah.
Now, you mentioned you were going to be doing some ballads for Disney. How did that come about?
Yeah, actually, that is I was just about to go to basic training. Mm-hmm. When it was 3 weeks before then, and this Japanese label that I'd been sort of courting when I was in Japan, they called me up and they were like, oh, we had a cancellation in our recording schedule, because they come to New York and record for like 2 weeks, and then they go back home for 4 or 5 months and mix everything and release it. And they had a cancellation in the recording schedule, and they're like, can you be ready in 3 weeks to do a record for us? And I said, oh my God, great, of course, you know, I'd love to. And they said, great, it's going to be... this is the caveat, right? They didn't tell. It's going to be it's going to be all Disney love songs. And I was like, great, cool. And so I only know two, right? How many do Someday My Prince Will Come and When You Wish Upon a Star?
There was one from The Little Mermaid, I think, that's really popular. And
but was it a love song? Only Disney love songs.
There was one in Shrek, too. I don't know if that's...
you when I was programming this? But anyway, I sat down in the basement of... I was living at the commune then for just getting ready to go. I was there for a few months. And I just was sitting down in the basement watching all these Disney movies, trying to pick out songs. And so we picked out the songs. I got my keys. I made charts. I went over to the studio of Fred Hirsch, the pianist, who's a very well-known jazz pianist, who was featured on the CD. And we worked out the arrangements. And there we were 3 weeks later in the studio. So it really, in a way, like it's the least, I was the least prepared for that recording. Mm-hmm. But it's turned out to be my favorite album. I love the songs and I love the playing on it. It's really beautiful. So warm.
Yeah, there's worse gigs you can get than performing for Disney or putting together something for
Disney. Well, it wasn't for Disney. It was just for this Japanese label called Venus Records. Mm-hmm. They put out wonderful artists mostly from New York. And so they asked me to do this Disney love songs.
Oh, okay. Yeah. I got you. Now, you've been to Japan. You went, last time I saw you, I think you were talking about going to Japan.
Yeah. I just played there for it was a big party for the Golden Globe Awards. For a television company mm-hmm. over there. So yeah, they flew me over to do like a 15-minute showcase of other songs that have been in the Golden Globe Award shows.
Very
previously.
Nice.
Yeah, so that was really neat. I got to play with some of my favorite folks over there.
Awesome.
And, got to have a little four-day trip, visit all my favorite places. I went to the onsen and laid in the hot water, and it was great.
Yeah, I would love to go to Japan. I haven't gotten that far east.
Yeah.
But here's what I would like to do. Now, where are you performing now, and how can our audience get a hold of you?
Well, all my performances are listed on my website at alexiscole.com. My name, alexiscole.com.
Okay.
And every Wednesday night, if you're local to Westchester, you can come and see me at the Division Street Grill. And I play piano and sing there by myself from 6:30 to 8:30. And other than that, my performances are listed on the website.
On the website.
Yeah.
And also they can get CDs and all that stuff from the website
as well.
That's
right.
Okay, terrific. Yeah. Now you mentioned...
I'm on iTunes and YouTube. I have my own YouTube channel and stuff like that.
Believe it or not, I was like the last person in the world to jump on the iTunes thing, but now I'm developing quite a library.
Oh, great.
So I'll be glad to download all of your music.
Oh, terrific.
Now you mentioned that we're going to be performing this evening for our audience, and that is from the album Someday My Prince Will Come, or the CD rather.
Am I
wrong about that?
Yeah.
No, sorry.
No, those songs are great, but they're more like for a band setting. So when I play by myself, I don't know, I have a repertoire of like American Songbook standards that I usually pull from to play by myself.
Okay, you actually mentioned the songs that you're going to be performing. Yeah. One is I Can't Give You Anything But Love, and the other is Corcovado.
Yeah.
And everyone, this is Alexis Cole.
I can't give you anything but love, baby. That's the only thing I've plenty of, baby. Dream a while, scheme a while, you're sure to find a happiness. And I guess all those things you always pined for, gee, I'd like to see you looking swell. Baby, diamond bracelets, Woolworths doesn't sell. Baby, until that lucky day, you know darn well, my baby, I can't give you anything but love. But I can't give you anything but love, baby. That's the only thing I've plenty of, baby. Dream a while, scheme a while, you're sure to find happiness, and I guess all those little things you've always pined for. Gee, I'd like to see you looking swell, baby. Diamond bracelets, Woolworth's doesn't sell, baby. Until that lucky day, you know darn well, my baby, I can't give you anything but love. I can't give you anything but love.
Terrific. And you were going to play another song? I think it's Corcovado.
Yeah.
Terrific.
I'm going to sing it first in Portuguese and then
oh, good.
In English.
Yeah. For all our Portuguese viewers.
Such a beautiful song because it talks about really feeling like a person who is feeling disillusioned in love. Mm-hmm. And then they meet the right person and they're like, I always thought that true love existed, but I told myself it didn't. But now I believe that it really does.
Well, it sounds familiar from what we were talking about earlier, right?
Esse amor uma canção pra fazer feliz o que se ama. Tanto tempo pra pensar e ter tempo pra sonhar. Da janela vê se Corcovado, parede em tu. Que lindo, quero a vida sempre assim, com você perto de mim, até o apagar da velha chama. E eu que era triste, descrente desse mundo, eu encontrava. Você te conheci. Que é felicidade, meu amor. Quiet night. Quiet walks by quiet streams, and a window looking on the mountains and the sea. How lovely. This is where I want to be, here with you so close to me, until the final flicker of life's end.
That was totally awesome. Where could we, what album was that on again?
I haven't recorded that song yet.
Oh, awesome.
Yeah.
Terrific. Why don't you come have a seat over here? And now we're talking about the arts basically in Westchester. Mm-hmm. And I've been finding that this is kind of like a sounding board for a lot of new artists. Can you give me an idea of anybody that you've been listening to or anybody that's up and coming?
Yeah, well, I don't know if once you're nominated for a Grammy, you you qualify as up and coming. But one of my favorite new singers is Gregory Porter.
Okay.
And he's on the same label as me, Motema. And he was just nominated but didn't win. But
which category?
For the, I think...
Best New Artist?
No, Vocalist.
Okay.
Best Jazz Vocalist. And yeah, his album, I think it's called Water. It's beautiful. And it's all his compositions. And he's just a very dynamic and spirited singer.
Okay. Now, do you write most of your songs?
No, mostly I draw from the American Songbook, which is you know, a set of standards written between 1930s and 40s, mostly.
Now, you have something coming out with holiday classics on it?
That actually came out in 2009. That was called The Greatest Gift, and it might be the album I'm the most proud of just as a producer because, well, for one, it's a benefit album for World Bicycle Relief. They're an amazing organization that... gives bicycles to people mostly in developing countries to help with healthcare. When I was doing that, they were working mostly in Zambia with AIDS, giving bicycles to volunteer AIDS healthcare workers. And it's really an amazing program that really helps people to help themselves. And I'm an avid cyclist, and so like working with them was really amazing for me. And
well, so you're really physically fit. You're an avid cyclist, you're in the army, and you're also doing this as well. Let's see. Now, what's playing in your car at the moment? Which CD do you have in there?
I've been listening to Jerry Allen's new CD. It's called Ascension. Or maybe it's Assumption, but I think it's... No, Ascension. I think
Ascension.
It's the name of it. Yeah. It's also on Motema. And actually, I got a bunch of CDs last time I was at the office.
Awesome.
So I've really been enjoying that. She's an amazing pianist, and it's a solo CD.
Oh, wonderful.
Yeah.
Now, besides performing and living in Peekskill, because you live in downtown Peekskill, what are some of the other arts that you like to enjoy in Peekskill or in the surrounding area?
Yeah, sure. I just went down to Purchase for the first time and saw an opera there that was done by students, which was absolutely remarkable. And actually, my teacher from my graduate program is also a professor there, my voice teacher, Sherry Overholt, who lives in Westchester with her husband. They're both opera singers, and they're amazing. And so that's a great venue that I've checked out recently. But
Which opera did you see that evening?
It was Bizet's Carmen, sorry. And also there was a Poulenc opera that was something like the Les Enfants de, I don't remember the whole name of it, but it was very, very avant-garde and bizarre.
Wow.
The singing was incredible, but they had all these bizarre costumes and it was about like, how we shouldn't procreate because we're going to ruin the world. And it was kind of a farce. It was a farce.
No, that's the truth, though.
it was very bizarre. I wish I had the translation of the score, but the singing was just outrageously amazing. I was so impressed. My favorite place to encounter the arts is in downtown Peekskill.
Mm-hmm.
I just love, we have so many, 5 music venues on my block. The Bean Runner, which has amazing jazz. A lot of the people that I love from New York City come up and perform there. Then there's across the street, 12 Grapes, which has a lot of rock and blues, mostly kind of blues with like a rock edge, and some folk singers. My favorite local artist is Steve Chismadia. Do you know him? Do you ever see him?
No,
play?
I don't.
Amazing songwriter. He's a folk singer-songwriter. Kind of sounds like Donovan or Dan Fogelberg, if you know the singers. And but his songs are just... They are so clever and amazing, and like they really touch you both in your head and your heart simultaneously, which I think is a real feat. And so he performs a lot at the Birdsall House, which they have music there on Thursday nights. And then, of course, I play at the Division Street Grill, but they have music there all the time, too. So, and at Rubens, and it's just teaming with music in Peekskill.
I know, exactly. That's why we want to have, you know, that's the whole premise of this show. We want to get people to take notice of the arts that are happening. Mm. I'd like to thank you so much for
thank
being
you.
Here. You're absolutely wonderful.
Aw, thank you.
And, basically, this is Jackie Suarez. We're going to be tuning out for Living Arts. I hope you've enjoyed this half an hour. I know I have. We're going to be airing Saturdays at 10, channel 15, but you'll have to check your local listings. It's in the tri-state area, and we'd love to have you come back next week. Have a good night.
So this is love. So this is love. So this is what makes life divine. I'm all aglow.